Welcome everybody to the e-meetup. Today with two special guests, we have Stefan and Maxime from the Erium team here as the hosts for today. We'd like to tackle the topic of mathematical modeling and how this gives you X-ray vision, just as Superman has. And if you have any questions, just post them in the chat, ask out, or yeah, throw them in loudly at any time. We also, or Stefan and Maxime, have also prepared a live demonstration. And yeah, I'm very looking forward to what you have prepared. Stefan, Maxime. Maxime, I think you were going to start, right? The yes. Stage is yours.
Thanks. Yeah, so Superman and X-ray vision and everything. So basically, we wanted to violate rule number one, which is never promise your customers magic. So, but since all of you are aware of what data science can do and cannot do, we felt safe to lay it down nice and thick. So we're going to structure this in like two parts. So I give a brief introduction just to get everybody on the same page what we mean with mathematical modeling. What are the principles, like very briefly. And then maybe we have a short question round there before then I hand over the screen to Stefan, who is going to take us through a use case that him and I did together for a customer where we applied this very successfully, I think. So yeah, let me start with explaining what are we even talking about here. So screen share. Should be starting now. We good? All right.
Works fine.
Okay, so very briefly, what do we mean with mathematical modeling, or you could also call it physical modeling? Let me give you like a very simplistic example. We have actually been using this in our now resting in pieces demonstrator ping, which we took to some fairs, where we shot like ping pong balls at a infrared touchscreen to demonstrate this principle. So this is not just a theoretical idea. So the example is you want to predict the trajectory of a cannonball. So since we have a limited budget to our affairs, we use the ping pong ball and not an actual cannon. What you want to predict is you have these two angles, alpha and beta. I always forget how you call them in spherical geometry, but one is like for up and down and one is for left and right, okay? And you want to predict where would the cannonball land? Like you have two target coordinates, X and Y, just normal Cartesian coordinates. And basically, so your inputs are the angles, your outputs are the impact coordinates. And obviously there's a normal machine learning way if you want to build a function that can predict the impact coordinates. Just normal plain old regression will do, right? So for example, neural network or support vector machine or whatever, where you just have a function that connects alpha and beta to X and Y. In between, it has a lot of trainable weights and you learn them by examples. So we just learn the weights of the network. What would be the modeling way, the physical or mathematical modeling way? Well, you just write down the physics of the system. So what does this mean here? Okay, so there's some exit speed to the cannon, which we don't know. It will be split into the various components of the speed, so horizontal in X and Y and the vertical component. And that's just trigonometry. And what you then want to calculate is, okay, what is the time of flight? For this, you will need the initial height, which you don't know, and gravity acceleration, which depending on what you think you know, you might know. So let's, for the sake of argument, assume you know it, but wouldn't change the principle. And then you can simply calculate the formula for the time of flight. And from this, you can calculate directly the output coordinates where the cannonball is supposed to land. And what you would then learn in a learning algorithm is the parameters S, exit speed, Z, the initial height, and T, the, no, that's a typo, you wouldn't learn T, but G, the gravity acceleration, because T is calculated. And there's basically two opposing ways to tackle the same problem. And maybe let's have a look at what are the advantages and disadvantages. So the regression way, well, first of all, it's easy to set up, right? You don't really need to think about what does this use case do. All you need to do is prepare your data in a usable way, have like a nice table, data frame, or whatever ready with the examples, and then you can get going. And it will automatically, yeah, details aside, but it will automatically adapt to reality. That's the nice thing about a regression approach. And it's also usually fairly scalable because you can just have like big matrices and stuff that can be parallelized on a GPU, things like this. Disadvantages of this way are you need lots of training examples, right? Because it could be anything. So you really need to map out the landscape. You have usually very limited extrapolation capability. If it's just a normal, fully connected regressor with not any further input, like for example, in convolutional networks, the very fact that you use convolutions is already helping. But if you don't do that and it's just a normal, fully connected network, you will have limited extrapolation capability. And also limited interpretability. So what do these weights mean? What the hell do I know? I just know if they work. I can't really say what they mean in a sense that connects to the real world. The modeling way, okay, so what are the advantages? A little bit like the opposite of the disadvantages of the regression way. So you have fewer unknown parameters, and therefore you need fewer training examples. Because here, I mean, what do you have? Like three unknown parameters, whereas in this network, even if it was actually as small as this, this is how many lines? I guess 8 here, then 16 here, and another 8. So 32 lines. So if you disregard biases, you already have here 32 parameters for this very small network, and only 3 in the physical or mathematical model. So obviously, it's more restricted. And this leads to, you need fewer training data. It has better extrapolation because you can imagine no matter in what part of the target zone, let's say I only use like a very small portion of the possible angles, alpha and beta. As soon as I have mapped out my parameters, exit speed, initial height, and gravity acceleration, this model is valid for any set of parameters. Obviously, in practice, reality kicks in and so on and so forth, but still the basic principle holds that a model that is informed about the physics is usually much more extrapolation safe and not that sensitive to where your data were in the parameter space that you used to learn. And the nice thing is the parameters that you learned are interpretable, right? I can explain what is the exit speed, I can explain what is the initial height, and I can explain what is gravity acceleration because I needed to understand it in order to set up the model, right? And that brings us to the disadvantage. You need to think up a model of reality, and that's usually more work than to just pick a black box the regressor out of the box and hit run. And of course, if you base your model on wrong assumptions, and in practice, your assumptions will always be kind of wrong, but maybe not 100%. You get also a wrong model in the sense that it can't arbitrarily self-correct because it has limited flexibility. So you really need to challenge your model in different ways than you need to do when you do regression learning. And per free parameter is more computationally expensive. So it might be cheaper overall because here we have 3 parameters versus 32, but those 3 parameters, let's say, have more computational load because the equations are not that parallelizable as the matrix computations that you have in a neural network regression. So that's basically what we mean when we talk about mathematical physical modeling. I assume many of you knew that, but just to get everybody on the same page, I wanted to reiterate that. Maybe if there are already questions or oppositions to what I'm saying, we can already have a brief discussion here. If not, then I assume we are all in agreement and I will move forward to like, okay, what is then Bayesian learning as opposed to classical learning? Because usually or often you use mathematical models and Bayesian learning in combination. So I want to very briefly explain this concept too. So the classical way to train a model is to set up a cost function where you basically say, okay, I take my predictions. That's the function that I'm learning. They take the input as an input and generate a calculated output. And that I compare to the actual outputs in my training examples, take the squared difference and average it over mini batches, all data that I have, whatever these expectation brackets then mean in detail. And that I can just minimize with respect to the model parameters, usually by some sort of gradient descent. The Bayesian way, well, would mean you need to set up probability distributions for all unknown parameters and the data. So for the inputs, a probability distribution. For parameters that define your models, so this would be in our previous example, the exit speed acceleration. And then you need to define the dependent parameters. Basically, what is your output depending on your input and your internal parameters, also as a probability distribution. And you can use then those to calculate the mean of what you actually care about to train your model, which is the mean of the parameters given your training data. Okay, advantages, disadvantages again. So advantages of the straightforward classical way. Well, it's straightforward, especially with like autogradient tools like TensorFlow and PyTorch, which have like all the, well, they do auto differentiation and they have all these gradient minimization and mini batch algorithms on board. So it's usually just a couple of lines to set it up. And there's many possibilities for optimization. My colleagues inform me that I'm stuttering due to internet connection. Is it still the case?
No, it looks fine again.
Well, all right.
Sounds fine again.
Sounds fine. Ah, robot voice a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. But I think the message came across.
Okay.
At least I understood what you wanted to say.
Well, that shall be enough. Yeah, and many possibilities for optimization because the approach is fairly simple. So you can think about stochastic gradients, mini batches, parallelization, sometimes even. So fairly useful. Disadvantages is, well, you will just find some fit for the parameters. It's not necessarily the best in whatever that means. It will just be the best or local optimum, probably at least for this cost function. But it's not necessarily the most stable solution because it can be really a point artifact and it could be that all the neighborhood of the solution that you found is like terribly bad, but this approach won't care. And therefore it's also prone to overfitting because it's really, there's nothing balancing out this fit. And therefore no matter how arbitrary or crazy your parameters values will get, if you don't stop the process in some other way, that's just where the gradient will take you. And missing data, yeah, you have to treat them somehow separately, imputation and the like. In the Bayesian way, well, the advantages is the parameter estimate is more robust in the sense that there's, if you use modern methods like variational Bayes, the environment of the point estimate will be taken into account. And therefore, like a really weird artifact solution that has like a terrible neighborhood is disencouraged. It's automatically regularized, so you have less overfitting problems if you set up, of course, your priors and everything correctly. And missing values can be treated consistently, although in practice it might be expensive to do so. Well, the disadvantages, more work to set up, as usual with models. But there are specialized tools that help you, like NumPyro or this thing called Halerium that we distribute. And it's also, again, computationally more expensive per free parameter because you're juggling probability distributions instead of just parameter values. But in combination with physical models, it's very powerful, and it's also, I mean, also been introduced into deep learning to some extent. If you think about variational neural networks, where they are, where Bayesian methods, or at least light Bayesian methods, are used to especially avoid this fact that you find like a solution with a terrible neighborhood. Okay, maybe short opportunity to for questions and comments before I get into the actual use case that we want to show you.
So maybe just briefly,
yes.
I thought like the Bayesian way offers also a little bit more possibilities for estimating errors, but so.
Okay. Yeah.
Did that take on this also? Or
that's like, true. I swiped it under the rug here. That's that's very true what you're saying. So, since you are dealing with probabilities, you don't only get a point estimate of your parameters, but rather you get an, well, here in what I described, if you only calculate the mean, that's a point estimate. But what you can do and often also do in practice is you calculate the mean and at least an approximation to the uncertainty. So this means you don't only have like a value for your parameters, but also a range, like how restricted are they by the data? Is the parameter 5 plus minus 10 to the minus 3, or is it 5 plus minus 1? You get that from a Bayesian method as well. Yes, Andreas, thanks. And the nice thing is you can use that then to basically have the error propagation as well. So when you then make inference predictions with your trained model, in a Bayesian framework, you can take these uncertainties into account so that basically your inference machinery is then also informed about, okay, the prediction is uncertain to some degree due to the uncertainty of the trained parameters. And yeah, this helps a lot if you, well, if you need to quantify the uncertainty of your predictions in any way, then this is a very important ingredient. Yes, thanks. All right. Then to the use case that we want to talk about. Well, it was with a company called Hahn Automation and Hahn Digital. And what they issue, what they produce, among other things, is automated testing systems, so-called end-of-the-line testers. What is that? That is a machine that at the end of a production line takes the workpiece that you just produce and puts it through a test in order to judge, is this good or not? It's usually done for components that need 100% testing, for safety reasons, for example. So in this case, it was an oil pump, which is a critical component. I think it was for trucks. And yeah, you don't want this to fail. You only want to put good ones in your truck. And the thing is, if you test these pumps, the standard way is, yeah, well, you just excite them with like a certain speed against a certain oil pressure. And then you record, okay, what are the flow rates and what is the torque that is recorded in the system. Basically, those are then lines and they need to go through certain boxes in order for the pump to be okay. And this is the classical way, but together with the Hahn people, we and with physical mathematical modeling, we took this a step further where we used the information that we had, the physical information about the system, which I here summarize in these two very simple equations. It wasn't even that complicated, but basing or formulating a Bayesian model around these equations allowed us to, and that's why we said X-ray vision, to look essentially into the pump. So we recorded then four pump parameters and two parameters even about the tester itself that you could not measure directly without dismantling the pump or dismantling the tester. So with the model, you can make parameters visible that you would only have access to if you essentially destroy the workpiece. And this then allows like for much more in-depth analysis of why is the pump wrong. So for example, this is a good pump. Everything is green, but here the pump is wrong because it has too much backward slip. That means that it is not tight in the sense that the oil can move from the high pressure channel to the low pressure channel, even though it should not be able to. And that was here the case because the pump, as it then turned out, like one of the internal wings, let's call it, was just broken off. Or in this case, the tester has a slip because of a broken valve. And in the lines, it actually looks kind of similar, but the mathematical model can distinguish between these two cases and tell you, no, it's not the pump that's at fault here, it's the tester itself. And that saves you from throwing away a actually good pump and informs you that you should maintain the tester. And for how we tackled the use case and how we did it in our software, I would now hand over to Stefan. So this is basically just that you see the result at the start so that you know what your attention is good for. All right, Stefan, please take over.
Okay, so I will also take over the screen now. So I hope you can see my screen now.
Yes.
And you can also hear me. So this is now our platform, and I will try to walk you through this basically this project by going through what we have here. So I will start with what you can see on the right hand side is sort of a mind map. And basically I zoom out and you can't read all the details, but you can see there's lots of these cards here that we have filled over the course of the project with some information. And I will start with the general description of the project. As Maxime already mentioned, we have an end-of-line tester for oil pumps. And so the basic information, what this project is all about, is written here. So we have this production line for oil pumps. We have a test station at the end of the line that tries to figure out whether a pump is okay or not by driving the pump and recording certain parameters and then comparing those these measurements to some acceptable ranges and then decide whether a pump is okay or not. So this is the basic information we had at the beginning. And so we asked further about the pump to see, okay, do we understand the pump more in physical terms? So here you can see a sketch of the pump. So this has sort of a cylinder which you have this sort of wheel with these wings, and basically this rotates very fast, and you see these maybe not very clearly, but you see that this is sort of has an oval shape, and here somehow these basically are essentially the chambers of the pump that then basically collect oil from the suction side, and then these wings sweep by and basically sweep the oil into one of two channels, output channels for this pump. So this pump has two output channels, one input channel, two output channels. And so to close that again, I had to move the Zoom window. Okay, so this is about the pump. So now what do we know about this tester, this test station? We know that we have a given protocol for the test, basically for a given set of times, the tester basically drives the pump with given set of rotation speed and puts it against a certain given pressure on these two output channels. And then it records basically the flow rate, the pressure on the suction side, the actual exerted torque on the pump, and temperature, and certain other parameters. So, now we of course went on and asked into more detail the experts, basically the engineers that are responsible for constructing these pumps, about all the details of all the parameters. What do they mean in detail? What parts does the pump have, and or the tester? What could go wrong? What they think, in their opinion, is the most likely cause of some failure? How could that be maybe seen? So we came up with certain ideas. What could be more important? What not? This pump pumps oil, so what about the oil? Is there something important we have to know about the oil? And so on. So we had certain ideas. Could that be, for example, do we have to consider the temperature, which is also recorded? The temperature could influence the viscosity of the oil. Could that be important or not? So this, basically, we collect a lot of ideas about the pump itself and the tester. Of course, then we also went into further detail of what is actually recorded and how. So we had a look into what is actually measured. And we made a list of what is measured exactly. And this is, for example, these pressures we mentioned, the temperatures, the rotational speed, the flow rates. There's also additional high frequency measures. The idea behind that is that pump that rotates very fast, and there are these. In this case, there are 12 wings for this wheel in the inner pump, and that will cause a certain frequency that could then also show up when you make a very high frequency measurement, for example, of the output flow rates. So this is also recorded. Then we had, of course, to decide what to go after first, and then we decided, for example, that we will not care more about the temperatures, not at the moment, not about these high frequency measurements as well. The next step is, now that we understand the basic physics of the system and what data is there, then one step is, of course, to figure out how to read the data. So we had a closer look into the measurement data, how it's recorded. And this is that they have a certain format, this so-called TDMS file format, which we had to look up what it actually is and what's in these files. And this helped us to create reading scripts or reading functions for reading in those into our system. And they can show you one of these features we have here is that we can, when we have such a card, we can actually somehow use that to document code that we create. And there's this neat little icon that I can click, and hopefully it will bring me to a place where I have actual code. This is a script now that actually, the code that actually reads in now the information from these files. And actually it's sort of linked to this card here. So actually I have more or less a direct connection between where I have my code and where I have the documentation about where I got the information about this code here. So once we have the data and we can read it in, then of course we have to now turn our physical understanding into a model of the system. So during the collection of all these information, we figured out that we need, apart from the measured quantities and the parameters that the tester itself actually controls, these control parameters, we have a number of these, we can call them hidden parameters or unmeasured parameters, which are for example, the effective volumina of these pumps, the slip coefficients that basically describe how much of the oil doesn't get pumped forward, but maybe slip back into the suction side or even between the two streams. And on top of that, we have also hidden parameters for the tester itself, which then describe, for example, if there is a leakage somewhere on the tester side. So we came up with basically this deciding that the first use case, as Maxime mentioned, would be actually to figure out can we with a physical model decide whether we have a pump that is okay, a pump that is broke, or maybe the tester has a problem. And so we take the physical model that we have, try to come up with a bunch of useful equations, try to put them into our code. And so here we have listed again, basically these equations that we came up with that describe the physical dependencies. So basically the mathematical dependencies between these different quantities. So we have the, as an example, we have the flow rate for the channel one can then be described as the rotation speed of the pump times the effective volume of the channel one. And then of course there's these other countering effects, which is the slip for that chamber, which then what kind of effect this has on the flow rate also depends on the pressure, basically here on the pressure difference between the pressure, the output pressure on the stream one and the suction pressure. There is this cross slip that basically describes how oil can slip between the two channels, especially when there is a pressure difference. And then on top of that, we have a term that describes what could happen if the tester itself has a leakage and could lose some of the, basically some of the flow could go there. The same for the second channel and for the flow rate. And in the end, of course, we can also describe, okay, what should be the power, what is the actual power consumption of that pump, which is simply, again, simple physics. You have the rotation speed and the torque. And then what we should expect as basically what's the power usage of that, where does all the power go for the pump? So we have for these two channels, we have, of course, the pumping power, that basically the physical power that you need to pump with this flow rate. Then you have friction. And then the whole system also has inertia. And so because the speed the pump is driven at changes, of course, this can then also be seen in some parts of the data. Okay, and so there's various places where we actually then can put these into code. This is, for example, one of these notebooks where we actually use our Halerium library to put these equations into code, into a machine learning model that we can train on the data. So here, at least at a glance, it looks like these equations show up here again in this notebook. And once we have coded up these equations in our version, our machine learning model, we then want to try to see whether it actually makes sense. So we made various tests on the consistency of the model. For example, we used then the model to try to predict, for example, what should be the torque that we measure on this pump, depending on the time. Basically, there's a certain protocol how the pump is driven. Here, this axis should be probably time step. That's like something like milliseconds or so. And here you see the torque, and the dotted line is what is actually observed. So what has been measured as a torque value, and the red line here shows what should be the prediction of that model. And looks like the agreement is reasonably good. So we were satisfied with that. We showed that to the engineers and they were also happy. And so we convinced ourselves that our model seems to be reasonably good, that we could go forward to use it to actually look at these inferred parameters from the model. And that would be, for example, the effective volume that we measure then basically by fitting data to these, fitting our data from the tester to this model, and then read out what is the effective volume for the pump for the channel one or channel two. And this is basically the values we got for different pumps that we measured. And these are also now values that we have physical numbers for, we can compare to actually, because this is actually very close to what should be the nominal volume of these chambers that basically the engineers told us. So it's at least for those. And here we see these are now pumps that have a defect. We see that the effective volume is noticeably lower. So this could then be used to say, okay, these pumps are fine. So they are within specs. So the effective volume for these channels is where it should be. So they pump at the capacity they're supposed to. And these two have a problem here. They don't pump at the capacity they should. So the next step was then to actually turn this into a demonstrator that is easy to use, in the sense that then the engineers of HAN Automation could actually show that to potential customers. Very simply, that they can take a file of these measurements of the end of line tester for a pump, put that in, and they get out just a few numbers, maybe a graph or so, very easily showing whether the pump is okay or whether there is a problem with the tester. And so we put this into a Streamlit app, which I'm trying to show you now. Everything works fine. App should run now, and it has a very simple interface. So it's designed that you can upload a file via the browser. So I have to drop in a file here. So I will take one, hopefully. So this is supposed to be a pump that is okay. Takes a few seconds to upload. So these are large files, and we don't even use most of the data. But this is now how this demonstrator works. So the actual analysis is quicker. So that has been read, analyzed, and now we hopefully see some results. And what we see here is simple color bars, which show us a range of value for certain parameters, for example, for the volume. The chamber volume for this second stream and the first stream. And this is the actual value that has been inferred from our model. And here the same. So they are in the green range, so they seem to be okay. So that seems that the effective volume of the chambers of the pump are fine. This now are the slips. This is basically the slip. So how much oil gets back instead of being pumped out onto the output channels, goes back to the input channel. It's also in the green range, so basically means it's consistent, or it's low enough to be consistent with zero, considered zero. And also this cross slip between the two streams is also comparably low. So this pump seems to be okay. And also we don't see any problem with the tester itself. So these are now these slip parameters for the tester, and they are also seen to be low. And so this is also now a very simple representation, so easy to grasp. Okay, are these values okay or not? These are the ones for the pump. These are the ones for the tester. So I can see whether the pump is okay or the tester is okay. So let's try one file that maybe is a pump that is broken. Let's see.
Is that a broken pump or broken tester that you're uploading?
Let's see. You know, it's probably a broken. The name says it's a broken tester. Yeah, let's see. Okay, yeah. And indeed, what the model tells us is that the pump seems to be okay. So the chamber volume is in the right range, and also the slip is low. But I see that there is some a slight problem with the test. So basically, I see a non-zero leakage of the for the tester in the first stream, and the file also says that basically there is a leak in the stream one.
Basically, the engineers knew, because this was a test tester where they could then basically dismantle everything and check everything and manipulate everything to challenge the model.
Okay, now I'm hopefully gonna get the file that has a broken pump instead. Let's see. Okay, so here we can readily see that these volumes are not where they are supposed to be. So they are sort of way lower than expected. We see a huge, basically, the slip parameter is very large. So we see a huge loss of basically oil getting, instead of getting put into the output channel, flowing back into the input channel. There's also some noticeable cross stream, but the tester seems to be, so at least the parameters seem to be indicating that the tester itself is still all right. So this would then tell us, look, for this pump is not okay, the tester seems to be okay. Even though, as Maxi mentioned, from the recorded values themselves, you can't easily see, you see that there's something wrong, but you can't easily distinguish by simply looking at the data, whether it's the pump or the tester that is not okay. So this is roughly what I plan to show you for this use case. We also discussed the second use case where we thought about maybe we could shorten these tests by only running a part of the full test and then using that data to predict the full test data. But yeah, so if you ask me a question about that, I can show you more about that. But otherwise, I think that's it so far.
Let's leave some room for questions, if there are any.
Werner Eberlein, hört man mich?
Ja.
Sehr gut, ja.
Ich bin im Camp der Kausalität und dem physikbasierten maschinellen Lernens, muss ich vorausschicken. Drum ist das eigentlich alles sehr gut, was mir da gefallen hat. Alles hat mir alles gefallen, was da gezeigt wurde. Zeigt aber doch auch, dass man für den Use Case, der hier beschrieben wird, einen Großteil der Magie des der AI gar nicht braucht.
Ja, also man könnte sagen, die Magie in dem Sinne, dass man einfach sagt, das System lernt alles aus den Daten, die wird hier nicht genutzt. Was aber gebraucht wird, ist die Magie, sage ich mal, der statistischen Modellierung. Was wir hier jetzt quasi nicht angerissen haben, ist das Thema, dass die verschiedenen unbekannten Parameter von Pumpe und Tester, die konkurrieren miteinander so ein bisschen, was sozusagen die Kurve erklären kann. Und nur durch ein statistisches Schätzwertverfahren kriegt man dann eben die richtige Lösung, die sich nachher auch dann ingenieursmäßig überprüfen lässt. Das liegt an dem, was ich zu Eingang geschrieben hatte, mit denen, dass man mehr braucht als den Punktschätzer, sondern auch diese Nachbarschaft der Statistik berücksichtigen muss. Also sagen wir mal, die Hälfte der Magie ist schon noch dabei.
Okay, bin ich einverstanden. Kann man denn dann auch rückschließen, wenn man irgendwo einen Defekt hat, welcher Parameter oder welche Kombination von Parametern da die Ursache sind?
Das ist im Prinzip die Idee. Der Defekt ist ja eigentlich definiert, streng im Prüfautomat, dass die Prüfkurve nicht durch vordefinierte Rechtecke geht. Und hier kann man dann sagen, okay, aber was bedeutet das in der Pumpe? Und wenn dann zum Beispiel das Pumpvolumen nicht stimmt, kann man daraus wieder Rückschlüsse ziehen. Wenn man jetzt natürlich noch einen Schritt weiter gehen will, okay, warum fehlt der Pumpe das Volumen? So weit sind wir hier nicht gegangen. Aber das wäre dann wahrscheinlich auch eine mögliche Erweiterung, das um den wahrscheinlich Pumpenproduktionsprozess noch zu ergänzen.
Gut, wurde ja auch gar nicht modelliert, ne? Also kann man dann auch nicht ableiten, ne? Das ist schon klar. Nee, ist sehr schön, hat mir gut gefallen und lässt sich ja auch auf vieles andere übertragen.
Mhm. Danke.
Heißt aber auch, dass man immer einen Domain-Spezialisten braucht, der einem das beibringt, was in dem Testobjekt dann letztlich vor sich geht.
Ja, ich glaube aber diese Erkenntnis haben schon viele, die auch ganz andere Ansätze im Data Science Bereich benutzen, schon am eigenen Leib erlangt. Dass einfach nur Daten über den Zaun werfen und mal loslegen, seltenst funktioniert. Aber widerspricht mir gerne alle anderen.
Also ich widerspreche nicht. Wir haben da schon vor 6 Jahren mal einen Versuch gemacht mit einem Kaffeeautomaten. Mittlerweile gibt es dann mehrere Leute, die das so als Spielzeug hernehmen. Also und die Data Scientists, wenn man denen nur die Daten über den Zaun geworfen haben, haben keine Chance gehabt. Man musste ihnen schon erklären, dass das ein Kaffeeautomat ist und dass das, was die einzelnen Parameter bedeuten und was da in dem Automaten vor sich geht.
Genau. More questions, comments, rants?
Tolles Zeug, was ihr da habt. Aber um es quasi zurückzuleiten zu dem Vergleich zwischen der physikalischen Modellierung und den regressionsbasierten Modellen, das ist de facto ein hybrides Modell, oder? Weil wenn es nur physikalisch wäre, dann wäre es wahrscheinlich ein Differentialgleichungsmodell, würde ich mal behaupten, oder?
Ja, es ist eine Vereinfachung der Realität, okay.
Ja, es sind eben auch, das ist eben dieser bayesische Ansatz, macht daraus eben gerade diesen Hybrid. Was halt dann immer auch in der Entscheidung natürlich ist im Projekt. Man hat da eben Spielraum, wie stark man sich an die physikalische Welt annähert, wie detailliert man in Richtung voller Simulation geht und inwieweit man Blackbox, klassisches Machine Learning dort macht.
Aber die Zeitdomäne musste nicht extra modelliert werden.
Das hatten wir auch untersucht, eben in dem Fall nicht. Es gibt natürlich... das System hat eine gewisse Trägheit natürlich, die sich auch daran widerspiegelt, dass es kleine Unterschiede gibt zwischen unserem Modell, was halt instantane Reaktion ist, der Pumpe auf die Parameter annimmt und den tatsächlichen. Aber die waren so gering in diesem Fall, dass wir sie auch vernachlässigt haben.
Also wir hatten die erste Ordnung, wir haben die Beschleunigung ja quasi reingenommen und damit konnten wir dann, wie Stefan sagt, der Rest war dann, die restliche Abweichung war sehr klein, sodass wir der Zeitdomäne entkommen konnten.
Sehr schön. Und im Hintergrund, ist das ein Bayesches Netzwerk? Oder?
Ja. Okay. Also, ab wann nennt man, sagt, spricht man vom Bayesischen Netzwerk, aber es sind wahrscheinlich bedingte Wahrscheinlichkeiten, die verkettet sind, also ja. Und die Formeln stecken halt so drin, dass die Formeln die bedingten Mittelwerte der abhängigen Parameter definieren und dadurch dann halt ein Bayesischer, also ein Variational Bayes Algorithmus dann das konsistenteste Set an Parameterwerten ermitteln muss, damit die Gleichungen halt noch aufgehen.
Sehr schön. Wie lange dauert es, das Modell zu trainieren?
Na, im Prinzip, okay, was Stefan gerade gezeigt hat, das hat gedauert, das war quasi die Inference mit einer Pumpe, die aber auch letztendlich das Gleiche macht wie ein Training, nur halt mit einer Pumpe, die das gesamte Trainieren, um aus dem quasi ganz frischen Graphen dann den informierten Graphen zu machen, würde ich sagen, hat aber vielleicht 10, 20 Mal länger gedauert. Also war jetzt nichts wahnsinnig Wildes. Also ich habe jetzt gar keine Zeit so genau im Kopf, weil es halt irgendwie, weiß nicht, 1-2 Minuten war.
Ja, also wie man gesehen hat, jetzt wie die eine Pumpe, das dauert ein paar Sekunden maximal. Wir reden dann halt eben auch von 20 oder 30 Pumpen maximal, die wir, wenn wir das gesamte Modell trainieren wollten, genutzt haben. Und da sind wir im Minutenbereich. Das ist eben relativ schnell, auch weil wir relativ wenig Daten haben und relativ wenig Parameter im Vergleich zu, weiß ich, Millionen Beispielen und einem großen, tiefen Netz.
Genau. Ich bin nur eine Abschätzung, weil es gibt ja auch die symbolische Regression, die versucht, von den Daten oder von den Trainingsbeispielen die Formeln zu lernen. Ja. Aber das ist eher im Bereich von Stunden bis Tagen.
Ja, gut, das ist wie bei den kausalen Modellen, den Graphen nicht aus dem Hirn, sondern aus den Daten zu kriegen, dann lasst das Cluster rauchen.
Schön gesagt, ja.
What a nice wrap-up.
Lass den Kopf oder das Cluster rauchen, meinst du?
Yeah, definitely. So looking at the time, we have to wrap this up for today. Big shout-out and thanks to Stefan and Maxim. Thanks for preparing and presentation.
Okay. Gladly.
All right. I hope this was insightful for all the participants. Let's check how much of this we can put online and then do so. And yeah, having said that, I'd like to advertise the next week's meetup. The title is pretty cool. It's Keyword Search is Dead, and so are Zola and Elasticsearch. Daniel Wrigley will be the speaker. I would love to welcome you to the next week's meetup. And if you have any one-on-one questions, you can stay in the Zoom meeting. Otherwise, feel free to leave. Enjoy the evening and have a good time. Bye-bye.